Hello and welcome to episode 16 of OperaVision's Next Generation series. I'm Nina Brazier, a stage director based in Frankfurt, and over this series we've been diving into four European Young Artist programmes, exploring how the opera world is developing and nurturing the next generation of talent. In this episode, we're looking at how voices in the opera world are calling for change to make it better for all our young artists. Opera has long been accused of elitism, racism, and misogyny. And over the course of the next few episodes, we'll be investigating the lives and work of artists who are actively striving to make the opera world a place where everyone feels welcome and equal. Is opera the most misogynistic art form? Demanded Charlotte Higgins in The Guardian back in 2016, noting that the genre itself seems to devour women. In Classical Music magazine in 2020, Becca Marriott argued that sexism is preventing women from forging a career in opera. I have invited three professionals, each with a different focus on women in opera, two from the UK and one from the United States, all of whom are challenging the status quo. This episode doesn't look at the wider representation of gender in opera, but that is something we'll be looking at another time. In this episode, we explore how masculine archetypes lead to a lose-lose situation for female directors, how scarcity of opportunity prevents women from speaking up, and why one mezzo-soprano no longer performs operas written by dead white men. And please note that there will be discussions about sexual violence. As always, let's hear some opening words from our guests.
There was a violent rape scene added into the story, and some of my male colleagues would sing along to the overture with the words, "We're going to rape you," before we had to go on stage and do the scene.
We keep the hardest things quiet because we are afraid of retribution, we're afraid of not being cast, we're afraid of being punished, and it's true.
It affects women and non-binary people, as well as people of colour, people with disabilities, those with working class backgrounds, and so on, because the people in hiring positions at the moment are almost always none of those things. And so that leads to all male creative teams, for example.
Dana Lynn Varga is a soprano, voice teacher, and career coach, and is the founder of Mass Opera and the Empowered Musician. I connected with her across the Atlantic late one evening.
So I am based in Boston, Massachusetts, and at the moment I am working with Boston Lyric Opera, performing the role of Clorinda in their production of Rossini's Cenerentola, and we're in the middle of shows right now. You know, just keeping up with my other roles as mom and artistic director of Mass Opera and as a voice teacher and career coach.
I'm wondering, when did you first become aware of this inequality of gender in opera? Was there a specific moment or realization?
I would say about the second year of my graduate studies, it really started to set off bells for me. Like, something's a little off here, you know, because in undergrad, I was in a state school and there was a huge emphasis on ensemble singing and less on opera. And I sort of just didn't notice it in undergrad. But by the time I got to grad school, I noticed how much more opportunity, you know, my male counterparts had. And, you know, just in talking to colleagues, I noticed, you know, we went ahead and talked about money, talked about scholarship, and we were all kind of freaked out by our loans and noticing that a lot of our male counterparts were not saddled with quite the same amount of debt. And then it sort of got me thinking and investigating and then set off a hunger for me to find out more from then on.
Prize-winning Welsh composer, sound artist and academic Derry Joseph Lewis and I caught up between London and Frankfurt to discuss his recent thesis in gender-based inequality in opera stage direction.
Why did you think of tackling this and why was it important to make this study at this particular time?
Well, I'm a massive opera lover. I spend lots of time watching opera, listening to opera, talking to other people about opera. So I always knew that my thesis would be geared in some way towards something to do with diversity in opera. And I was really inspired by some wonderful and groundbreaking research particularly a 2021 study by Vincent Coles and Vincent, by Clément in the 1980s, and by my supervisors at King's College. In terms of why it's important to make this study at this time, to be frank, I don't think it could come soon enough. It's really important to ask these questions of opera so that it continue to flourish for the next couple of hundred years, but perhaps in a slightly more fair and equitable way.
Why do you feel you're the right person, in inverted commas, to be making this study?
Throughout my research, most of the people that I spoke to were surprised or at least curious to know why a man was interested in studying this. And I think that that response actually speaks to the general state of affairs regarding people's attitudes towards equality. But I think that caring about equality and diversity of any kind should be all of our responsibility. And as a matter of fact, being an outsider in this study, i.e. not being a woman or a non-binary person, was actually a bit of a tactical advantage. It meant that when I was interviewing these female or non-binary directors, they couldn't actually assume that I had any shared experiences regarding gender-based discrimination. It meant that the research I gathered was actually very detailed because they weren't assuming anything.
Can you tell us briefly about the overall structure of the study?
So what I'm trying to do is draw links between gender-based inequality, informal recruitment practices, and working conditions, all within the field of opera stage direction. So the work has a brief introduction about the scope and the background of the opera industry, and then kind of dives into any existing literature. There's actually a very limited academic literature and other writings like newspaper articles about the subject. So I had to kind of draw parallels with other creative industries like screenwriting for film, for example, or being a freelance classical musician. So next, I detail my methodology, which involves anonymously interviewing female and non-binary opera directors about their experiences. And then the whole study is summarized with my findings.
I've had the luxury of reading the whole study. Your study shows that we experience gender-based inequality in four clear different ways.
Well, the four different ways that female and non-binary opera directors experience gender-based inequality can actually be broken up into two groups. So the first group is about informal recruitment practices. And my research particularly highlighted the importance of networks and of homophily, which is basically just an academic word, which means we're more likely to trust what we already know. Birds of a feather will stick together. And this means that it affects women and non-binary people, as well as people of colour, people with disabilities, those with working class backgrounds, and so on, because the people in hiring positions at the moment are almost always none of those things. And so that leads to all male creative teams, for example. It's definitely changing, but it's nowhere near reflective of our wider society. Based on my findings, I understand that most stage directors are actually hired based on inviting artistic directors to their previous shows. But if they aren't hired in the first place to do those shows, then they can't invite people to their show. So that's kind of the first group of experiences. And the second group is actually more about the working conditions. So there are long working hours. There's frequent international travel. These are all things which systematically exclude, for example, mothers or primary caregivers who simply can't spend 14 hours a day in a rehearsal room or relocate to a different city every 7 or 8 weeks.
Il n'a jamais connu les loups.
Mezzo-soprano Rosie Middleton specialises in new music and contemporary opera and is doing her doctoral research on power dynamics for singers, informed by her own difficult time during her early experience.
I think on some level I was aware that opera was telling stories that were pretty old, in which sort of women did tend to sort of suffer quite a lot, but it was so normalised and so sort of part of the job, I didn't really question it at that point.
You worked for 5 years in what we would probably describe as mainstream opera before coming to a point where you decided to pivot your focus to contemporary work. What was your experience like over those 5 years, and how did that decision come about?
Well, I did, during those early years, I did a mix of solo and chorus work with like some smaller and larger companies. And in this time, there were some really great experiences. I learned a lot about stagecraft, particularly from working with some of the smaller companies because we were so close to the audience. However, during this time, most of the roles I played, whether in chorus or as a soloist, were prostitutes. And with that came a lot of intimacy scenes, but also the portrayal of sexual violence on stage. And this was before the Me Too movement happened. So there was sort of very little consideration or care taken around a lot of these scenes. The culture was quite jokey. I remember one particularly awful contract in which the male director told us to pair up and create an orgy scene. This was a chorus contract. There was no direction given at all. And there were a lot of rape jokes during this time. And unfortunately, during this contract, I experienced both sexual harassment and assault on stage and off by one of my colleagues. These were not isolated incidents. And over those 5 years, there were others where lines were crossed. In another opera directed, this was directed by women actually, but there was a violent rape scene added into the story. And some of my male colleagues would sing along to the overture with the words, "We're going to rape you," before we had to go on stage and do the scene. It wasn't all like that, but they added up. It did get quite difficult.
More on that later. The soprano and opera career coach Dana first came to my attention back in 2020 with the study between middle-class artist and the empowered musician titled "Excluded, Penalised, Indebted, Harassed: A Study of Systematic Discrimination Against Women in Opera." The study was led by Zach Finkelstein, together with Dana and Hilary Labonte, and includes some shocking statistics. The figures we hear on gender distribution in training are based on US studies, and those on role distribution are referenced from a global study.
In academic training programs where you study classical voice, we're training approximately 70% women and 30% men. And if you look out into the operatic professional world, in the operatic canon that's regularly being programmed, particularly the top 25 operas, then the numbers skew somewhere between 60 to 70% male roles and 30 to 40% female roles. And so if you think about that, we are training two-thirds more women into the field. And then once they enter into the field, there are two-thirds more roles for men. That means that a man is approximately 3.5 times more likely to be cast in the professional operatic world.
And it's not only in the casting of singers where the odds are set against women, as Derry Joseph Lewis's research in the UK reveals.
My main starting point for this study was a brilliant piece from 2021, which is by Caitlin Vincent, Amanda Coles, and Jordan Beth Vincent. And they did a numbers-based study of a major opera house, which really demonstrated some awful things, namely that the role of stage director is unequivocally male-dominated, with all male creative teams really common, and that only 8% of canonical works are directed by women.
That is extraordinary. And do you happen to know what percentage of the output was canonical works overall?
About two-thirds of what is performed can be described as canonical box office winners. So of those hits, 92% of them are being directed by men.
Dana has discovered that inequality of opportunity is evident right at the training stage.
So I'm quoting the study here. In post-secondary training, inequality of opportunity is the norm, not the exception. Academia masks women's exclusion by admitting so many of them, charging them more and featuring them less. And this sounds exactly like what you experienced in your training. Tell us about how else does the inequality of opportunity show up so early in training? And do conservatoires over-admit and overcharge women?
Well, it's not just conservatories. You know, conservatories are sort of the biggest offenders, but it's schools that have voice programs in general. There are exceptions. Certain schools make it a mission to have gender parity. It's rare. But it is very true that there are far more women admitted. My own personal theory is a lot of us, especially in my generation, which is Generation X, were raised as like, you can do anything, you know, pursue your dreams, which in a lot of ways is a positive thing. But we were led to believe that we can pursue anything we want and encouraged to do that. And I'm by no means saying that pursuing music as a career is a bad idea, because having a degree in music can ready you for any number of careers. However, you know, this did lead to a sort of influx of many, many, many people studying voice who maybe weren't necessarily prepared for the realities or necessarily even at a level where they should be pursuing that. And so, yes, there are more women admitted and they do tend to get significantly less scholarship. And part of the reason is that the schools know that women will put up less of a fight about those financial rewards because they will have fewer offers, and the offers they do have will have lower scholarship, and men in general will get more money from more schools. They'll have better options. They can negotiate more, etc.
I'm thinking and trying to play devil's advocate here. Women going into an opera career could now, of course, with your article particularly, look at the statistics and get a sense of the opportunities and risks and, of course, costs that are involved. Do you think singers need to be more realistic about what's achievable?
Absolutely. Now, I want to be really clear because I never want to set a negative tone, and I never want to be the person who says, don't do that, you know, don't pursue this. But as a career coach and a lecturer, I give a lecture called The Many Paths to a Career in Singing at institutions and organizations across the country about 20 to 30 times per year. And when I give this talk, I talk in at length about correlating careers. I think that especially women, but really all singers, need to not only be aware of what we're talking about, but if they do decide to pursue it anyway, then I think that they can give it their all in music while also being sure to work on their other skill sets and ensure that they have skill sets that will enable them to have correlating careers, which are careers that run alongside their performance careers. Now, note that I don't call them plan Bs or fallbacks or side hustles. I'm talking about income streams that will be long-term. That must be part of a young singer's plan from the get-go in 2023.
And I'm thinking with that gender pay gap starting at the training stage, does that change or improve later in women's careers when they're more likely to take on the major roles? Or is that then counterbalanced by motherhood, caring duties as and when and if they come into play?
The answer is it depends. It depends on the individual person and how much career success they're enjoying. It depends on if they're a mezzo or what type of voice they are and how rare their voice type is. And even how tall they are. You know, there's so many things that can come into play there, but certainly motherhood, once that comes into play, that really does affect pay in so many ways, because even if the pay is very high or the pay is on par with what their male counterparts are making, which isn't always the case, then we're talking about how are they going to manage the childcare? Is their partner able to care for the children while they're singing? I know that many, many women, and I've written a couple of articles about this, they spend half or more of their fees on caring for the kids. And they also are overlooked for roles regularly, because even if a company won't say explicitly, like, we are not hiring you because we're worried about, you know, how you're going to travel with your family or how you're, if you're going to be able to handle this, they can't say that, you know, that they can't legally say those things, but that doesn't mean it doesn't regularly happen.
As we touched on earlier, women are less likely to be chosen for canonic works. And as Derry's work points out, and I quote, women are more likely to be chosen for non-canonic works, which have less prestige and are less likely to be revived. Speaking as someone who would be excited to be given a new or lesser known opera to direct, is this really such a poison chalice?
I mean, artistically speaking, no, it's not a poison chalice. You're right that it actually is very exciting to explore and devise and share non-canonical works, whether it's a rare opera that fell out of favour or a contemporary opera. It's a brilliant way to explore ideas from different perspectives and perhaps right the wrongs of the canon. But financially speaking, in terms of employment and repeat employment, non-canonical works are a bit of a poison chalice. My research points towards the employment practices in opera being based upon inviting people to shows, the prestige from reviews and from peers, because the whole thing is just so precarious and unregulated. So if you're invited to direct La Traviata or Tosca, your work will be seen by thousands more people. It will gather bucket loads more of attention and is more likely to put you on an equal footing with other more prominent directors. And that will lead to more employment. So it's a sad observation and I don't like it, but that is how it is.
Back to Boston with Dana.
An alarming part of the study looks at exclusion, harassment, and assault as experienced by women in the opera world. And I wonder if you noticed a pattern of experiences emerging from the women that you were interviewing and whether women were actually leaving the industry altogether.
One of the patterns is that women simply don't feel heard. If they raise a concern, they're ignored or they are not heard or listened to. Another pattern is that women are scared to say anything in the first place. This brings us all the way back to the beginning of our conversation, which is if we know that roles are so scarce and that these opportunities are so scarce, then understandably, women are terrified to say something if they are dealing with harassment or assault or even just inappropriate behavior, because it took them a lot to get to where they are in that production or in that role or in that, you know, concert or whatever it is they're doing. And so often they just don't open their mouth because they're afraid to lose the opportunity. And so lots of women become frustrated or upset to the point where they simply say, you know, it's not worth it to me to be a part of this industry anymore. And again, I would say that there have been great improvements in this. I'll give a shout out to Boston Lyric Opera. I mean, we had workshops and mediators from the very beginning just to set the tone for a healthy workplace. So a lot of companies are doing right by women when it comes to creating safe havens, but we still have a long way to go.
Despite her unpleasant experiences, leaving the industry wasn't on the cards for Rosie, but something had to change.
Whilst I was struggling with those things, actually, I've always really loved new music. And every job I did that was, you know, with a living composer was much more interesting than the jobs I was doing, you know, where the composers were dead men. So I've always really enjoyed the research and development phase of projects with composers and directors at sort of early stages of projects. And I realized that in that space, I did have more agency as an artist, and I guess for me, the work was just much more interesting. So actually, like the pivot really was a positive one. Those experiences were a factor in me falling out of love with traditional opera, but I don't see them as the sort of, you know, the main reason why I'm doing new music. I'm much better at new music and I really love it.
We heard Dana mention Boston Lyric Opera and other industry players who are working to redress the balance. That includes her own company, Mass Opera.
So Mass Opera's mission is to reflect our diverse community and also to challenge the status quo, which is sort of a Dana Vargas special. The Dana Vargas special is always to challenge the status quo. We have done 18 operas in 15 years, and our stats are 66% female roles. And the majority of those roles are double cast. So we do prioritize female singers across the board. And we try to do that creatively. Yes, we've done Suor Angelica, sure. But we also will find ways to either gender bend roles or do double bills. Or in one case, one year, I believe it was 2018, we did this really fun all-female La Boheme called La Femme Boheme, which was a blast. But, you know, we did Traviata, which is, does not have gender parity. And the way that we solved it was, this was during COVID. And so we did the show 18 times. As a walkthrough opera in a mansion, and everyone was masked. And so only 30 people could attend at one time. And so we had six rotating violettas. And so we come up with whatever ideas we can creatively to ensure that women are prioritized, just to help in our tiny, tiny, small way to reset that balance issue that we have across the industry.
Rosie has recently had her own experience of redressing the balance, putting women at the centre of the story.
So I was in Laura Bowler's The Blue Women last year at the Roll-Up House, and that opera looks at a woman's experience in the aftermath of a rape. Unlike most of the operatic canon, there's no men mentioned in the opera really at all. The perpetrators mentioned once in the prologue, and then after that, it's entirely focuses on the experience of the women. And that felt like, to me, a very important part of the story, because I don't need to see any more women being violated on stage. I've seen it enough. I know what it looks like. I know what it feels like because I've been on those stages. But I think showing a sort of 3D portrait of a woman in the aftermath and the complexity of that, but also like in The Blue Women, like Laura Lomas and Laura Bowler created a story in which the woman isn't portrayed as a victim, but as a sort of complex human with lots of layers to her survival, and she does ultimately survive.
Thank you.
Dana Lynn Varga, if the scarcity of roles for women sets us against each other as competitors and stops us from supporting one another or embracing each other's success? Or can it bond women together in an industry that seems in so many ways to be set against us?
I do think that younger women struggle with this. And I try to encourage people not only to understand that there are many different ways to be a singer and not just following the pipeline and being an opera singer specifically. And there is room for everyone if you zoom out and if you lift each other up and if you do band together, because by lifting each other up, we can band together and make change and say, hey, this is not okay. Or if we, you know, band together and start new companies or start new initiatives or start new studies and data points and articles, I mean, and podcasts, right? Like the more we come together and say we need change, then change happens. And so I find that as women in this industry get older, they realize that competing against each other is a fool's errand.
What about Rosie's early experience? Had that at least united her and her female colleagues in their outrage?
Not at all. Because it was so normalised and it was happening, you know, I know from conversations with colleagues that this is fairly widespread, but at the time, I kind of thought I just had to do the job. And I guess I felt I was quite desensitised to it to some degree. So I certainly wasn't, I certainly didn't tell anybody what was going on. I know colleagues who have tried to speak up and speak to companies about these experiences, and there's been a really mixed response. Whilst, you know, there has been the response of, yes, we hear you, ultimately, the people that have assaulted friends of mine are still working for these companies and my friends are not.
That speaks volumes, doesn't it?
Yeah, and that's more recent than my experience. This is post-Me Too, not pre.
Yeah, it's extraordinary because I was going to ask you if you get the sense that post-Me Too, that some of this behaviour that was going on is now less acceptable and the, let's say, the climate of speaking out is absolutely embraced. But actually, from what you're saying, it seems like that is absolutely not the case.
The culture has shifted. There is now an understanding that it's not acceptable to make rape jokes, which there wasn't before. You know, certainly bigger companies in this country are using intimacy coordinators, which sort of takes out a lot of the opportunity for casual crossing of lines. So I think that things have improved there.
Speaking of problematic behaviour in the rehearsal room, I asked Derry where men fit into this.
Something that jumped out at me in your study was the idea of the ideal typical artist, in inverted commas, stemming from masculine archetypes. Tell us about him. Who is he?
So there's lots of research done in the film and TV industry, for example, that points towards women working in the more administrative or facilitation roles because they are, to quote someone else's words, incredibly well organized or nice. Whereas men fit more into the aggressive hard man attitude, like a lot of entrepreneurs or city executives who are allowed to explode with rage and be incredibly demanding. There's a really interesting phenomenon that lots of my participants spoke about, that as a female director, it's basically a lose-lose situation. So if you model your behaviour on these stroppy, tortured artist male directors, then you come across as bossy or as crazy. But if you attempt to be more human, more empathetic, more understanding, then you come across as weak or as people-pleasing. So for female and non-binary opera directors, the masculine archetype of the director is actually really harmful.
And of course, misogyny doesn't begin and end in our role as a director. As you say, and I quote, the way the industry is even formatted contributes to gender-based inequalities in almost all areas. And for our listeners who have not yet had a chance to read the study, what are the areas that you refer to here? And what do you mean exactly by the way the industry is formatted?
The history of the art form is generally dominated by male voices. The repertory is almost completely founded upon works written by male librettists and male composers. And a lot of the works in the canon are based on very problematic stereotypes. if you were to take a look at the list of the most performed operas today, you can identify incredibly problematic misogyny and racism in all of them. And women effectively have to retell these horrific stories every time they come to work. So the entire format of the industry really perpetuates the inequality.
Are there any signs of hope that the profession may be better for the next generation? A question I put to all three guests, starting with Derry.
I think there's so much brilliant work being done right now across the board in universities, in conservatoires, in studios, in casting, in rehearsal rooms, in coaching, in the media, and beyond all of that, that really points towards now being a real turning point for the next 400 years of opera. But we must never be complacent and decide that now is enough. We can always fight for more equality, more diversity, more equity, more inclusion.
Something that happened on a job I did in France recently is that the company hiring us sent us their sexual harassment policy in advance of the contract starting. And that was sort of spelt out in black and white what was acceptable in the workplace, who to go to if there was a problem, and how things would be dealt with. And that's a hugely positive step. There's protections there. But if you're a freelancer going from summer festival contract to summer festival contract, for example, as a chorus member, then you can really feel like you have no power at all. And I think that, like, we in the bigger houses, then there's really great work being done. But we need to be thinking about all singers across the, you know, within the profession, whether they're in the chorus or singing lead roles at La Scala, like the care needs to be there for everybody.
I don't know. I really don't know. It depends on a number of factors. Will academia take accountability for how many women they admit and how much scholarship they get? I mean, think about sports, right? We have Title IX in sports. And Title IX means that there has to be an equal number of opportunities and also an equal amount of financial assistance and scholarships. We don't have anything like that in the arts, and that's troubling to me. So will academia take accountability? Will composers take accountability, and librettists? And this is a big one, right? And librettists and composers love to argue with me about this, that that's not their job. Their job is to tell important stories. Yes, yes, your job is to tell important stories. But could you not also take a moment and look at everything that I've presented to you here and that Zach and Hillary and I have presented to you here and say, wow, I really need to prioritize female identifying voices in my work? Librettists and composers can have a huge impact in what happens next. And so getting buy-in from them, getting buy-in from academia, and finally getting buy-in from opera companies and organizations across the country and world, I just don't know the answer. I hope so. I'd like to have hope that the more we talk about this, and thank you for being here talking about it with me, the more we talk about this, the more we can hope for change.
Finally, I asked our guests, what do you think we can actively do to create positive change in the future? First up, Rosie, on steps taken by the Royal Northern College of Music.
I think training institutions can do a lot of work with around consent. And if intimacy coordinator, I know that the RNCM's just brought in for the first time an intimacy coordinator to do a workshop with their students. I don't know who else, how widespread this is, but I think the more that we do that and get singers used to kind of being able to advocate for themselves in a way where they'll be heard, I think that would, you know, empower them to then go into the workplace and treat each other with the respect that they need to do the job well and safely.
Number one is just talk about it. One of the reasons we've gotten ourselves into such a pickle, and it's not just in the opera world, it's in the arts world as a whole, and one could say in society as a whole, is to talk about hard things. We keep the hardest things quiet because we are afraid of retribution. We're afraid of not being cast. We're afraid of being punished. And it's true. You know, people ask me all the time, aren't you worried you're going to advocate yourself out of a job? And I'm like, no, I'm not, because It's more important to me to have the hard conversations and do the hard work than to ensure my own safety. And, you know, there's an amount of bravery in all of us that takes. But I think we just need to keep talking and talk about money. Talk to your colleagues. How much scholarship did you get? Oh, what was that like for you? How much are you being paid for this gig? And, you know, again, I think that leaders and composers and librettists and directors and every single artist involved can make positive change by, you know, calling out bad behavior, by not accepting toxic environments as the norm. And like I said, appealing scholarships, negotiating contracts with more fervor. The possibilities are endless, but the coming together to voice our concerns and to regularly have each other's backs and look out for each other as we move forward and try to make positive change is absolutely crucial.
The most important thing, I think, is talking about it. I identified a real sense of fear during my research about talking out, of a culture of silence, of upsetting the wrong people, or being seen as ungrateful. But the more opportunities that we get to speak truth to power, to learn and understand more, I think that the future can be really bright. And I think that the next generation has it right. I think it's very easy for me as well to speak more about it because I'm not affected by gender-based discrimination. So I think it's definitely about alliance, about allyship, of fighting together as a sort of union against so many things to ultimately make the opera world a better place.
Thank you so much to Rosie Middleton, Dana Lynn Varga, and Derry Joseph Lewis for joining me today for this episode. And thanks to you for listening. There's plenty more online at operavision.eu, where you can see From Studio to Stage, a documentary with young artists at Oper Frankfurt, the Opera for Peace Masterclasses with Eileen Perez and Brian Jade in Paris, Il Viaggio a Reims from the Accademia Rossiniana's Alberto Zetta, and Non Bulé Lo Yende in the final of BBC Cardiff Singer of the World. I'll link to those in the show notes and give details on all the other music extracts you heard in this episode. This series is edited and produced by Karen Piri and curated and hosted by me, Nina Brazier. OperaVision is co-funded by the European Commission.